I shall not want.
Please stand with me as we sing our first couple of songs here. We'll start with Her Eyes.
Thank you.
may be seated.
Stories of the Bible. Elijah in the wilderness. This is Elijah.
Hello.
Elijah was a prophet in Israel during the reign of King Ahab. This is King Ahab.
Whatever.
He came from the line of kings who did bad things, but King Ahab was the worst of them all. King Ahab and his wife Jezebel stopped following God and worshipped a fake god called Baal. Elijah's job was to tell the people of Israel and King Ahab to stop worshipping Baal and to worship God again. But King Ahab and Jezebel didn't like what Elijah had to say, or that he proved to everyone that God was more powerful than any other god. Elijah made Jezebel so angry that she wanted to kill him. She sent him a message saying, "May the gods strike me and even kill me if by this time tomorrow I have not killed you." Elijah was terrified and ran away. He went to a town and he left his servant there.
Go on.
Then he went on alone into the wilderness. He sat down under a tree and prayed that he might die. He said, "I have had enough, Lord." Then he lay down and fell asleep. But as he was sleeping, an angel touched him and told him,
"Hi.
Get up and eat." He looked around, and there beside his head was some bread baked on hot stones and a jar of water.
Whoa!
So he ate and drank and then laid down again. The angel of the Lord came again and touched him and again said,
"Uh-oh.
Get up and eat some more, or the journey ahead will be too much for you." So he did, and it gave him the strength to get up and continue on his way to a place called Mount Sinai. Later, Elijah would do what God wanted him to and would tell the people of Israel to follow God again.
Well, it seems like years since I've been up on the stage here. But anyway, here we go. Prayer time this morning, we will join our hearts together I'll share some prayer requests from our Wednesday morning prayer group. This week on our church prayer list, we have Blake and your family, Brendan and Marina, and Holly and their little guys as well. So we've been praying for them. We've been praying for Iris's niece, Debbie, who has had health issues but is doing better. And also Ken's daughter, Francine, cancer in the roof of her mouth and had that removed, and we're praying that she will be totally free and clear from cancer and that will heal up well for her. Of course, we've prayed for our COVID crisis, our kids in our schools and those types of things, and seems to be getting more instead of getting less, but we'll just pray that God will get us again through this fourth wave and that this will find an ending. And I keep going back to the verse that says, if my people will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. And I thought, sometimes I think, is that what God is waiting for? Not sure. Just thoughts that come into my mind. I have a friend, Donna, a school friend, much younger than I, but she's been diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. Never smoked a day in her life, but that's what she's dealing with right now. So I'm praying that she will get through this and that somehow God in his mercy and in his miraculous ways will get Donna through this time and back to good health. And of course, as we all are praying, hopefully for our church and for a pastor, that God has somebody in mind, and that will work itself out, and we will get a pastor. Anyways, those are things that I would ask you people to be praying for through this coming week. But let's just spend a couple of minutes in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day, Lord, and we thank you for the good harvest weather that we've been enjoying, Lord. And we know that the crops are not as good as they often are, but Lord, we thank you that they've been able to come off and get into the bins, Lord, and we do thank you for that. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have kept us safe and healthy, Lord, through this pandemic, that your hand has been upon us, Lord, and especially our kids and our grandkids, Lord. We are so thankful that you have been their strength and their protection, Lord, and we just pray that you'll keep that hedge of protection around each one of them, Lord. And Lord, I pray that our young people, Lord, that their hearts would remain tender toward you. Heavenly Father, they've grown up often to learn about you and know how much you love them. And Lord, we just pray that as they grow and get to be adults, Lord, that they will remember those things that they learned, Lord, and that they will choose to follow you. Bless each one of our young people, we pray. Heavenly Father, we think of these things that I've shared this morning, these prayer requests, Lord, and we know that you love us. We know, Lord, that you have a plan for our life. And each one of these things that we've mentioned, Lord, we just pray. We pray your mercy on each person. We pray your healing touch upon each person, Lord. We thank you. We thank you that you are there. We know that you love us. And Lord, we thank you so much for that. Heavenly Father, I just pray that you will be with our church, with our congregation, Lord. I believe that you have a pastor for us, Lord, and that will come to light, Lord. Right now, it's just been such a difficult time through this pandemic. But Lord, I do believe that you have a plan for this church and that somebody will come and fill that spot and lead us, Lord, and be our shepherd, Heavenly Father. So we just leave that in your hands and ask that you work that out for us. And Heavenly Father, I just pray that you'll be with each one of us, Lord, through the coming week. Lord, that you will bless us, that you will help us. Lord, that you will walk with us, Lord, and help us, Lord, above all else, help us to show your love to those that we come into contact with, Lord. And let them see something different in our lives, Lord, and perhaps even ask us about that, and that you will give us the words to share with them, Lord. So, Heavenly Father, I just pray again your protection upon each one of us, Lord. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that you will help each one of us to be the people that you have planned and designed and created us to be. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, and we do love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
How about I turn this on? Thank you, Pastor Brian and Pastor Jody, for ministering to us this morning. We're going to continue our journey through Psalm 23. For those of you that might be joining us for the first time in this series, we've been going through verse by verse Psalm 23, and we've been doing a deep dive into each verse and unpacking for ourselves what the Lord would have for us in each of those verses. And Psalm 23 is a very, very rich text. David, when he wrote it, was in the middle of a lot of strife and struggle. And Psalm 23 is, at least to Pastor Jody and I and Pastor Brian, we felt like Psalm 23 was a beautiful piece of scripture for a church that finds itself pressed on all sides from COVID. And so we wanted to press into Psalm 23 as we begin to unpack what does it look like to be a church when we feel surrounded on all sides, when we're not comfortable, when things are hard or difficult and we're outside of our comfort zones. What does King David have to say to us through Psalm 23? So This morning we're continuing in verse 5. So verse 5 says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows." So there's a number of different pieces going on here in this little verse. It's pretty dense, meaning that David's packed a lot of meaning into what is essentially two sentences. And as I was reflecting on the density, meaning how much David's got in this little verse, I brought to mind three questions that I thought could help us continue our journey in unpacking as we set aside all the different pieces of verse 5, three questions that would guide our journey this morning through this verse. So they are, number one, who is preparing your table? Or what's on your table? Question number two is going to be, do you remember your anointing? And then question three is going to be, what's overflowing out of your cup? So these are three questions that we're going to use to guide us as we unpack what David might be getting at and what that could mean for us, a church that finds itself in the middle of COVID and all the other stuff going on in our lives. Jesus, I pray that as we look deeply at the scripture, that your Holy Spirit would speak to each one of us. As we reflect on what David meant here, may it illuminate to us something about yourself and something about ourselves. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, question number one. Question number one, who is preparing your table? In the psalm, David says, you, God. God prepares his table. And he has this qualifier about the preparation of the table. He says, God prepares a table for me in the midst of my enemies. And that's a weird phrase. And I've been turning this phrase over. Like, Lord, what did David mean? What's the deal with preparing a table in the midst of my enemies? And I had to get into the mindset of David. So David, for a big chunk of his life, David was just running. Like the poor guy, like he had people after him all the time. Like literally spears and swords after him. Not just, I'm gonna say stern and mean things to you. But like if they catch up with him, the guy's dead. So David lives a lot of his life in caves. He lives a lot of his life in the wilderness. He has Jonathan helping protect him at various points in this story. But I think it's safe to assume that when David wrote this passage, there was someone after him. And those enemies, if they caught him, would have significant consequences for him. Now, as I put myself in that mindset, I began to imagine myself with the Lord preparing food or preparing sustenance or preparing things that would restore me or feed me or help me survive, whilst all those enemies are around me. And that got me thinking. Today, I don't know about you, but I don't have actually anyone with like a physical spear or a sword literally chasing me. Most of us in our church wouldn't have a physical like death threat on a daily basis. However, it's no surprise that all of us have enemies, meaning all of us have things that feel like they're pressing in around us, that feel like they're cornering us, or they're coming at us, or we don't know what to do and we're worried about them, or we're stressed about them, or we get anxious or frustrated or angry about them. And so I thought it would be helpful as we continue this journey in verse 5 to think about what's surrounding our table. What are these enemies that are pressing in on us? Some of them could be money, right? So as money gets tight, what do we feel? We feel pressure. As we lose a job, or perhaps we lose a source of income, or some other monetary thing happens, and money starts to press in, and those fears and those stresses start to push in on us. Sometimes these enemies around our table can be relationships. Relationships that have gone bad. Things were said that caused wounds and hurts. Perhaps this is a fight with a spouse or a neighbor or a coworker or a family member. During COVID, especially, depression and anxiety and stress feel like enemies pushing us in on all sides, don't they? I call it the COVID tax. I take my stress level and I add 30% just because we're in COVID. And then when I do that, I go, oh, right, that's why I'm stressed out. That's why. Like COVID itself, just the fact that there are regulations that I have to remember and follow. I had a dream the other night that I went in a restaurant without a mask. I was terrified. I woke, you know those dreams, and then I'm running to try and find my truck, and where's my mask, and I can't find it, and they're gonna yell at me, and I'm gonna look like a, like, this is going on in my head. This is what, I know you don't, you know, we're not gonna share too many what's going on in Ian's dream head publicly, but this one was interesting, and it clued me into, oh, right, I'm stressed about that. Oh, right. Even though I don't name it, even though I don't talk about it a lot, it's just there. It just, as I'm sitting down to my table, it's just there, staring at me, pushing at me. Physical sickness and unhealth and death are also enemies that can be around our tables, pushing at us. So I want us all just to close our eyes, and I want you to sit at a table. Now, last night with the kids, we asked them what their table looked like. And there's a number of good, trained in the ways of the Lord Rider fans, and they said green. So they said green tables was their table. Some said, I want a table made of cookies, which I thought was quite ingenious, and that would be a nice table to have. Others said brown, but we all have our table. So whatever, you know, you got your table, is it big, is it small, is it made out of wood, maybe it's made out of something else, cookies, but you're at your table. Now imagine, what are the enemies in your life surrounding you as you sit by yourself at that table? What are those things? Just put a picture there, or an idea, or a word, or a thought around your table. What is sitting there pressing in on you right now? Like today, this morning. All right, so we've got this idea, this image of these enemies around our table. All right, so we're still imagining, we've got our table, we got our enemies. Now I want you to do a thought exercise about what foods are on your table. What foods are on your table? Now, when I was talking with the kids, we talked about breakfast. And so we all put our hand up if you're orange juice, and we all put our hand up if you're apple juice, and some of us were milk, and there was water crowd with lime, I think we had. We had a whole bunch of a wide range of breakfast beverage consumption. Chocolate milk is clearly the best, just putting that out there. And we asked the kids, what is on your breakfast table? And then we asked the adults, okay, adults, what's on your spiritual food table? When you think of these enemies, these imaginary enemies that you thought in your mind, what are the things that you put on the table to help you cope with them? What are the things that you put on your table to help you deal with the pressures and the stress or the anxiety or the depression or the relationships or the sickness? What are the things? These are oftentimes called coping mechanisms. And they're very human and they're very normal. But as Christians, we need to take account of them and make sure, A, there's not too many of them, and B, that we're taking care of quantity and size, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. But what are some of your coping mechanisms? So we have pacifiers, things that make us feel good. Oftentimes this is substances, right? My life sucks, it's hard, I don't want to have to deal with it, so I'm going to consume this because it makes me feel better. I will do anything just so that I can feel better, because the enemies around me make me feel terrible, so I'm going to do this so that I feel better. Sometimes we put on our table things like distractions. I'm just going to go on a vacation, forget about life, all my enemies disappear, and I don't have to worry about them again. This is one that oftentimes goes on my table. I love movies and television. I love losing myself in the story. But I've noticed when my enemies press in, I have a tendency to kind of lose myself from reality and dive deep, way deeper than I should, into movies or television because I want to escape the enemies that are around my table. So I put this coping mechanism of losing myself in these stories and these movies, and when I come up for air, I realize I actually haven't dealt with any of the enemies. They're still there looking at me. So then what do? Well, I got to watch more movies. I got to do more TV. I got to do more escape. Some of us have our table, and we go and we get big pieces of cardboard, and we stick the cardboard around the table, and it's really tall. We stick cardboard all the way around our table, and we go, there, I don't see any enemies. Good. This is called blinders. Some of us have blinders on to our enemies, where we ignore them, and we just say, oh, they don't exist. There's no enemy there. It doesn't actually change the fact that they're there. And usually it doesn't change the fact that long term they evoke in us stress, anxiety, all of these things. So some of us surround our table with big blinders. Some of us put maps, detailed maps on the table. And we write out every single thing. Maybe we got spreadsheets and flow charts, and we know exactly which enemy's where, and we're going to attack it with a specific strategy, and we plan out every aspect of every part of our day because we're not going to let the enemies win. Well, that looks a lot like control. And so those of us that struggle with that table, man, we can get lost in our maps. We can get lost in our spreadsheets and our charts, and we actually may not ever take steps because we're so busy mapping everything out. Some of us fill our tables with a pyramid. So I asked the kids, if you had a breakfast table, how many eggs do you think you would take before you couldn't see your mom and dad on the other side? We landed about 500. I'm not sure if that's true, but I think 500 eggs would make a pretty good pyramid that you couldn't see over. Some of us fill our tables so full, fill our lives so full that we can't see around them. And then we go, ah, see, no problems. I'm too busy filling my table to look at that. Right? So this is your typical workaholic. This is your activity person who constantly needs, if they're not moving, they're dying. Right? So this is the person that constantly is filling things. Why? Not because necessarily they're high capacity, because if they stop for a moment and clear the table off, they got to look at all the stuff around it that's surrounding them, and then they get anxious. No, I got to put more on the table. So then they always have this nice big pile of stuff that they can kind of bury their head in and lose themselves in. So we go back to our prayerful imagination. You got your table. You got the enemies that you named around it. What are your coping mechanisms? What are your things that you've put on the table? What does your table look like? What does it look like at your worst? When those enemies push in real hard and they start yelling things at you and saying things to you and your mind starts, this is crazy. What goes on your table? What's your thing that you go to on your table? Now, imagine for a second that Jesus comes along and he clears your table off. He clears your table off and he says, son, daughter, I have good news. I have better things for your table. I have better things for your table. Now, Jesus says that the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So Jesus wants that to come out of us. And so he puts onto our table things that will grow that fruit. Things like prayer, worship, which we just did. Scripture, unpacking the scripture, which we're doing this morning, but also privately. We can unpack scripture through times of solitude and devotions. Fellowship. That's one of the things that COVID has hindered the most in the church, is this communal fellowship where we all get together. Been a long time since we did a potluck, hey? But fellowship is a spiritual act that we can put on our table that, when done well, builds more fruit of the Spirit in the followers of Jesus. Things like communion, bread and juice. We do that. We try and do that very regularly around here because we believe that it builds the fruit in the lives of the followers of Jesus. Reflection and journaling, fasting, spiritual disciplines that build into us fruit. Acts of service, taking care of someone else. Putting that on your table, man, that helps a lot with some of the enemies around you. It's really weird how when you begin to care for others, like the things that press in on you seem to take a step back somehow. I don't know, I found that in my life. Here's the thing. We're a couple weeks into Lent, but we still have 3 weeks left. And Pastor Jody and Pastor Brian and I, we didn't do a Lent series this year. We felt led to do Psalm 23. So we didn't make a big deal about Lent starting, and we didn't do a big church challenge or anything. However, I did feel prompted to remind all of us that Lent is a time of table sorting. It's a time where we go before the Lord and we say, Jesus, here's what's on my table. Is there anything on my table you'd like me to take off for a season? Is there anything on my table that maybe I need to just kind of put off to the side or take off the table? Is there something not on my table that you'd like me to put on? If you feel convicted about something this morning, consider the next 3 weeks of Lent an opportunity to do some table sorting. To say, Lord, my table is yours. Is there something on it that we should shuffle around? And maybe he'll ask you to take something that's really big or something that's gotten out of control and it's sprawled all over the table. Maybe he'll ask you to gather it up, set it to the side for a time, and you can try one of his exercises, one of his spiritual practices to build fruit on your table. Question number two. David says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Then he says this interesting phrase, you anoint my head with oil. You anoint my head with oil. Now, in the time of King David, anointing meant setting apart. It meant taking someone and declaring that they are special and they are set apart for a reason. And typically, the leaders of the Jewish faith were anointed. They were set apart by God, by a priest of God, for ruling the people or leading the people, both spiritually and politically. Now, David had an anointing, and he received it from the Lord, as if the Lord was giving it to him. And this made me wonder, do we have an anointing? Like, have you received an anointing? And this led me to 1 John 2:27, which says, as for you, followers of Jesus, the anointing you received from him remains in you, and you do not need anyone to teach you. But as his anointing teaches you about all things, and as that anointing is real, not counterfeit, just as it has taught you, remain in him. So Scripture says that as believers in Christ, we have received an anointing. And I began wondering, like, what could that have looked like? And immediately my brain was brought to baptism, right? This idea that as believers, Jesus commands his believers to be baptized. And he says, this act of baptism is a setting apart. You are no longer of the world or in the world. You are set apart for me. And the act of baptism is this setting apart, this anointing. And so I began to reflect on that, and I began to think, okay, well then, I think most, if not all, believers in Jesus at some point move into this setting apart, this, all right, Jesus, I'm ready to declare that you are Lord of my life. I'm ready to take this statement. Set me apart for you. And it's called baptism. Do you remember your baptism? Like, for some of us, that's a while ago. Some of us, it might be pretty recent. Mine was extra special. So I was living in Georgia in the mountains, the Appalachian Mountains, and it was a crisp spring morning, and the church I went to didn't have a baptistry. They didn't have like an actual tank or anything. So we figured the next best thing was a pond at one of the members' houses. So we went to this pond. Now this pond was filled with mountain runoff. Yeah, I heard some audible like, yeah, mountain runoff into this pond. And I'm thinking, pond, this is going to be Saskatchewan boy summertime. I'm thinking, woo, you know, cannonball, this will be great. No, it was like barely feel my feet coming out of the pond afterwards cold. But man, do I remember it. Man, do I remember my baptism. And I had my brightly colored trunks on, and I waded out, barely able to breathe. And the pastor, she said to me, she said, Ian, do you wish to be set apart for Jesus? Do you wish to follow him wholly, as in with all of me? And I said, yes. And she froze me and raised me again, a new person gasping for breath. But something happened there. Something happened there. And as Free Methodists, we believe, let me just be clear, baptism doesn't save you. All right? Baptism is not a salvific issue. As Free Methodists, we believe that your relationship with Jesus is what saves you. Baptism is a next step. It's a part of that journey, that relationship with Jesus. So it's not a salvific act. However, there is power in a baptism. We believe that something happens to a believer when they declare, "I'm all in, Jesus. I'm all in." So, if you're watching this, it's one of the things I've been thinking about. How do we talk about this more? We don't talk a lot about baptism around here, but I want to put it out there. If you want that anointing on you, if that's something that you want, if you're watching us or listening on the radio, if you want that anointing, we would love to talk with you about that. Because something profound happens in the life of a believer when they take that step. So, baptism is that anointing. What is that anointing for? What are you set apart for? Matthew 28, 18 to 20 says, "Then Jesus came to them, the disciples, and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing, anointing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.'" So Jesus says, your anointing isn't just for you. The Great Commission says that when you receive an anointing, your job is to now go anoint others, to go and share that news, that good news with others, and help them become anointed. And then those anointed go out and anoint more. That's the spread of the church. That's the beauty of the love of Jesus, a light on a hill shining into a city. So, my question is, do you remember your anointing, and are you living it? Are you living into that commission that anointing has given you? King David, he didn't live into his anointing all the time. There's some pretty big mess-ups in Scripture where he put some stuff on his plate that he wanted. God wasn't too happy about that, but he repented, and he said, "No, I am anointed for God. I want to live into that." Question number 3. What's overflowing out of your cup? So Psalm 23, the last part says, David says, "My cup overflows." Now, I believe that if we do the first part, which is if we set our table appropriately, and the second part, which is remember and live into our anointing, then I believe the third part isn't actually of us. Our cup overflowing isn't something that we magically make happen. It isn't something that we have to think really hard. Cup overflow. We can't manufacture this. When I was young and I wanted to watch TV shows of questionable moral character, my mom said this one phrase, "Ian, garbage in, garbage out." And it stuck with me. Why? Because she was essentially implying, Ian, if you fill your life with this stuff, you're going to start to look like it. You're going to start to act like it. You're going to start to sound like it. So maybe be careful about what you put inside. I think that applies to our spiritual tables. As we reflect upon what are we putting on our tables, what activities, what coping mechanisms, what fruit of the Spirit go on our table, same rule applies, garbage in, garbage out. Now, if we do this well, if we allow Jesus to fill our spiritual table, even in the midst of our enemies, and we remember our anointing, our cup overflows with fruit. It'll overflow with fruit of the Spirit. We will be loving and joyful and kind and peace bringers and gentleness. We will be full of gentleness and we will be self-controlled and we will be faithful believers in Jesus. However, if we fill our tables, sometimes our cup doesn't smell very much like Jesus. Doesn't mean our cup doesn't overflow. Our cups can overflow with a lot of stuff that doesn't look and smell like Jesus. Something to consider. Now, if we forget our anointing, sometimes our cups dry up. Hey? Do you notice that? If you forget, right, I'm supposed to give this away, this isn't just for me, then our cups can dry up. And we actually lose some of what is this stuff that Jesus is trying to grow in us, and we kind of shrivel up and you know, the vine, right? Remain in me, remain in Jesus. If we disconnect ourselves from the vine, we kind of shrivel up and our fruit shrinks and maybe our cups aren't overflowing. So both of these things are required. A good table set with Jesus' stuff, remembering your anointing and living it out, results in an overflowing cup. Now, the last call or the last commission on this cup is that it overflows not just for you, right? Pastor Brian, would you mind coming and giving me a hand up here? So, I have my cup, and it's full of Vico chocolate milk. It's amazing. It's super tasty. Terrible for you, but I love it. So my cup, my favorite breakfast drink, and all right, we'll make it healthy. It's water, okay? So I got water, and you're over there, and it's like the best water ever. Hint of lime, so good. Maybe it's BC water. I don't know. It's probably not like Weyburn well water, I'm guessing. So this is, what's that?
Nickel
Lake water, definitely not. We're not Nickel Lake water. We set our table well. No Nickel Lake water. So we got beautiful spring water, and it's just pouring out of my cup. And you over here are thirsty. Oh, you would love some BC water, I bet. No, you don't understand. I got to save my water. This water, super special. You don't understand how special my water is. I gotta keep it close. Yeah, I know you're thirsty. Maybe you go find your own water because I've got mine and I'm hanging on to it because it's special. Thanks, Brian. That's absurd. Someone who's thirsty and comes to you and says, give me water, and we say, no, I'm hanging on to it. Ah, that's absurd. And yet, as Christians, sometimes we forget that the reason our cup overflows isn't for us, it's for them. Who's them? Neighbors, coworkers, family, friends, anyone that the Lord puts you in the path of another, that is a them. Your cup overflowing is for them. Yes, it sustains you. Yes, it builds good fruit in you. Yes, it's for you. Yes, and it's life-giving in you. Yes, but God's purpose isn't just that you be a beautiful plant by yourself. God's purpose is that you grow on the vine and you produce fruit, and that fruit flows out of your cup and it feeds others. And it anoints others. And it leads them to Jesus. So, this question is, what's overflowing out of your cup and are you sharing it? If what's in your cup these days is kind of Nickel Lake, go back to the table. If you got some Nickel Lake coming out of your cup, just go back to the table. No, it's not that big of a deal, but there is a source. There will be a source when smelly stuff comes out of our cups. There will be a source, and if we ask the Holy Spirit to address it and lead us to it, we can fix it. God will help us fix that. If your cup is dry, go back to your anointing. Go back to your anointing. Why is it that you were set apart? What is your job as a believer? What are you living for? Go back to that anointing and go to Jesus and say, God, I need you to drive that deep into my heart. I need that to be deeper still. I need to be fully in my being about other people and about others. And then if you have good things coming out of your cup, just remember to share. And it's not a share as in like running around throwing water on people. No, this is a share as in I've got some. Oh, you'd like some? Here, let me share. Oh, you'd like some? Sure, let's share. This isn't like spray park. This is just as God brings people into your life, just share the water you've got. 9 times out of 10, what I've found in my life is that the water that Jesus gives my cup and is overflowing is exactly what the person who God sends to me needs. Funny that. Let's pray. Jesus, I pray that your people would be diligent as we set our tables. I pray that as we think carefully about our spiritual lives, that we would be diligent in allowing you to put things there that will ultimately bring out fruit in our lives. Jesus, if there's something on our table that we need to remove, Holy Spirit, we invite you, come and tell us, show us, convict us. Maybe these next 3 weeks of Lent are a time where you will show your people some things and say, hey, Let's clear this off the table. Let's make this a little smaller. Let's clean up this mess. If there's something you want on our table, Lord, show us. God, we want the things of you. If there's a spiritual discipline or practice you would lead us to, nudge us with it. Maybe send us a friend to do it on a journey with that we can do it together. Whatever it is, God, just gently nudge us. We will follow. God, remind us of our anointing. Remind us that you set us apart for a purpose and a reason. And that's to go out and anoint others. Jesus, if there are people out there in the sound of my voice that need that anointing and want that anointing, Holy Spirit, nudge them. Jesus, would you call your people into that anointing, into that next step of beautiful baptism relationship with you? And lastly, Lord, would you remind us to share our cup? Holy Spirit, when we're busy in our days and we're running around and shopping and working and living and parenting, Jesus, just remind us, help us to stop and listen to your Spirit and go, oh, right, I got some water to share. And in doing so, may we quench the thirst of those who need your water, who need to hear from you, and need to be healed by you. So do these things in your church, in me, and in us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.